I finally am gonna get to do something I've wanted to do ever since they came out, which is that I'm gonna be able to do a review of the limited edition SLA 017, the reissue of the 62 MAS. I've been curious about these. I mean, I've seen a lot of the pictures. When they were first announced, a lot of people said, oh no, it's a hoax, they're not really making them, but then they came out. People were very excited. I nearly pre-ordered one, but then I held off for some reason. I don't know why. I was unsure about a few elements, but I didn't really want to make any judgments about it until I actually saw one in the flesh. So here it is. Here's the SLA. The finishing is great. It's typical for Seiko. The finishing is beautiful. I mean, very clean design. I wasn't 100% sure about this bracelet. I mean, I liked the bracelet itself, though it would have been cool if they'd gone with an H-link, but I wasn't sure about this odd end link. I'm not entirely sure why they went with something like this that stood aside, that looked basically like it was borrowed from another watch model to put on here. I would have assumed that they would have just made it flush, but maybe they wanted this to stand out. pardon me. I think they were trying to have basically a nod to the Marine Master bracelet, which we see there. Let's see the good things. Now, when Seiko reissues these watches, the last time they did something like this, really, they sort of reimagined an original, is when they reimagined the 6159 7001. And so they came out with sort of a limited edition in the year 2000, and then they came out with a general release, which was the Marine Master, which we can see right there. And Seiko sort of reinterpreted it. And as Seiko has this sort of thing where they like to beef things up, and so that's what they did here. You can see how much higher on the wrist this Marine Master sits. They just made the whole thing beefier, and whereas like this, the indicator ring, the rotating ring, is flush with the crystal, here it's a good, what's that, a full millimeter or more down? They made the dial a little tighter. They made the insert a little bigger. They made the markers a little smaller. It changes the proportions, changed the feel of it. This is kind of a burly watch as a result. It's very much of its time. And in some ways it sort of misses the refinement and simplicity and elegance of the 6159. There's a reason that these are starting to be a high four and low five figure watch now. Not just because they're incredibly rare. They're rare because people buy them and they put them away. And they're rare because they weren't made for long, but they're beautiful. People pick them up now and then they don't really sell them. The people selling them now are trying to make a killing before the reissue comes out at Baselworld. And we'll see how that reissue does. Okay, so the idea being then, pardon me, Seiko has a tendency to sort of beef stuff up, so I wasn't quite sure how this was gonna come out. And they did in fact beef it up a little bit, but unlike the Marine Master, it isn't like on steroids. So here we are. This is an original 62 MAS from 1966. And you can see they made it a little taller, but not a ton taller, just a little bit. And you can see they made the coin edge a little taller. They made the case a little taller. They just sort of added some extra height, like this right here. That section of this case right here was like plugged on. If you got rid of this and dropped the case back down, it would be much, much closer to the original height, but of course the 8L55 movement is, I'm sure, much taller than the 6217, which is in this. So one of the things that I had been hesitant about, I have sort of a crazy mania for how Seiko did their watches in this time, is one of the things they loved doing was they loved knife edge finishes, absolutely flat surfaces, knife edge finishes, so completely flat and chromed and sort of, gosh, a cat got in here, Kraken, what are you doing? Stop that. Yes, Kraken, I hear you. I might have to evict the cat. We'll see how upset she gets. She's somehow burst in here, and now she's orbiting my feet. So, flat surfaces. So it's one of the things that's a mark of this of Seiko. They were really, in the old days, really particular about that. Like the even the later 6309s and some 548s, absolutely flat hand surfaces, completely sharp edges. Later, they got sort of rounded and sort of blobby. And Seiko fell prey to that here. They did fine with the hour and minute hands. They're nice and sharp. But here you can sort of see the sweep hand is kind of blobby. Let's see if I can do this in a way, in any way that makes sense. Oh, Kraken, you're going to make me kick you out of here. Kraken, you do not go on my workbench. You're not supposed to be here at all. I know. Get for not closing the door. Anyway, I don't know that I'm really going to be able to show you this. I'm going to try. Let's see now. If you hear Kraken complaining, that's what's going on. So you can see this has sort of a rounded hand surface. Like the top is not completely flat. It's sort of blobby on the top, whereas the hour and the minute hands are nice and sharp. So they did the hour and minute hands right, but then they sort of drop the ball on this versus having the completely flat hand surface. Another thing that I was worried about was one of the glories of the 62MAS is it's got this real 3D effect on the dial. Let's see if I can do this. Come on, ignore all the dust and stuff. See the depth in there? See the depth in the loom? Whoosh, I needed to blow this thing clean. But do you see how the loom is underneath? Gosh darn it. See how the loom is underneath? The cat's trying to get in again. I'm trying to do this. Boy, this must be so annoying. You guys probably want to kick me. But see how the loom is dropped down below the level of those high sharp markers. That gives it a nice 3D effect. Oh, and there you can see the flat hand surface on that sweep hand. There it is. So that was something I really wanted to see if they could do, was to really get that 3D effect going on, because that was kind of a big deal for the 62MAS. It's one of the things I loved the most. Well, let me blow this watch. Let me do what I should have done, which is to blow that watch clean. Let's see what we got here. And this, it looks, I mean, they kind of did that, but they did a fully flat fill. It's only slightly dropped down, and you'll notice even the edges of these markers are kind of rounded inside and out. They're not like that crazy knife edge. Another thing that I wish they had done, you can't really see it. I'd have to pull the stem and do this. That space between divers and 200M, it's too big. The kerning's wrong. I don't know what they were thinking. They wanted to have the outside edges of that text be uniform, but even with that, it's like the M sticks out further than the S in jewels. Why did they have that giant honking space there? I don't understand what they were thinking. The dial surface itself is beautiful. The printing is, of course, nice and clean. The loom is bright. I mean, overall, it's a nice watch. I mean, you must be sitting there thinking, God, does he do anything except complain? But the watch, it just, you know, I'm sort of a details guy. So I look at this and I'm like, there are just things that if I had been there in the drawing room, you know, the drawing board, and there are things that I would have mentioned, because, you know, the devil is always in the details. And they got so much right with this. Like, I love the insert and I love the silky feel of this. I think that's really cool. But then you have the little details. Like they went with sort of an etching. I think that maybe that's a laser etching on the back here, rather than a stamping, which I personally believe that was a mistake. I've always liked the 3D effect of the old style case backs. I always thought that was nice to have a stamping. And considering it's a limited edition, maybe they wanted to spare having to make the tooling, but they made the tooling for the whole darn watch. But that said, on the wrist, it's actually a lovely sort of balanced piece I like the height of it, actually. I think the height of it is actually more appropriate. One of the things about the original 62 MAS is it always feels a little bit sort of light to me. It feels a little old school. Feels a little old school. This has nice heft to it. It's a good size, 39 millimeters, and it's not, so Seiko beefed it up a little bit, but they didn't punch it like it was on steroids, like this thing, which is its own beast. I mean, these have lineage in common, but they're visually and wearing wise, they're absolutely different watches. I just wish they hadn't made this one as high. And what's kind of crazy, okay, so they came out with this, which has an 8L55 movement in it, right? And I always wondered with this one, why in the world did they have that big honking back sticking out? Why didn't they make the back flat? I've never understood it. And it's like, well, maybe the movement stack is too high, but look at this. They could have easily done it. They could have absolutely recreated this case without that big old back, because this flat case back, that's the deal. I mean, that's one of the great things about this elegant case. But maybe when they have the reissue coming from Basel, that'll do the thing. They'll do that. Okay, so here's the last thing though. Okay, to recap, I like the watch. Visually, it's nice. I like that it's a sapphire crystal. Nice thing there. I think they did a lot of things right. There are a few things that I would change. I would change the sweep hand. I would change the text down here. But beyond that, I mean, it's really okay. I mean, if they made the lume a little more 3D effect, I think that would look nicer, but the dial is not nearly as, it's not nearly the killer that I thought it was going to be when I saw the photographs. In person, it has a beautiful depth to it, gorgeous depth to the dial, and again, you can see the flashing of those flat hand surfaces. It's so important. But there's one other thing that drives me crazy. This is a limited edition watch with an 8L55 movement. It's basically brand new. It has been run in. This has had a good amount of wrist time, months of wrist time. Okay, this watch is fully powered. This is a high-end piece. This is a $4,000 watch. I have not opened this watch. This watch has not been opened. It has absolutely been run in. Look at the numbers. Let's put it on a time grapher. It's heartbreaking. Wait a second, let me turn that around. Hold on, it's not hearing it properly. Let me turn that around. Okay. Well, I have to say though, that's actually better than it was yesterday. I've been letting it run and run and run and run and run, and it's at full power. Yesterday, I was getting amplitudes in the 260s. But still, even with that, this is a high beat $4,000 watch. We've got beat error, and it's out of adjustment. And it's not an entirely clean signal. And what's crazy is that my original 62 MAS, my other one here that I serviced and rebuilt, it has better amplitude than this one, and it's more accurate. And it only is at 1800 BPH. It just, look at it, it's just a messy signal. Why? I don't understand it. The watch has not been mistreated. I've never opened it. It's not been bonked. And yet this is what we're seeing. I don't think there's really an excuse for this. I mean, I don't know that it left the factory this way, but you would think this would have settled down. But like stuff like this, like that, this beat error and being out of adjustment, it's maddening. If need be, I will adjust this watch. The amplitude is definitely better. Yesterday, when I was looking at the numbers on this thing, it was in the 260s, and that was like, I was like, are you kidding me? The 260s for an 8L55 high beat. This is better. It's better. That's acceptable. It's acceptable. That's fine. It's higher than it was. But the fact that it's still out of adjustment, and the beat error yesterday was like 0.5. I had two distinct lines, but this mess, what's that mess? What is this stuff? We having palette fork issues in a brand new high-end watch? I don't know. So I will look at that and adjust. I accidentally stopped my video. So I will look at this and adjust it tomorrow. And perhaps. But then, I don't know. I don't really have a scoring system. I guess it comes down to yes or no. Yes, I would say. With some reservations, yes. I love the case. I love the case. I love the height. All that stuff is really good. I mean, the minor details I can get over. I think the only thing that truly, truly bugs me is that space right there. That and the beat error, but now that the amplitude's higher, I can adjust it out and it'll probably be fine. But I shouldn't have to. Especially for a limited edition watch. I'm not sure, quite sure what's going on with that, but that's it. Oh, one last thing is Seiko also provided a new version of the waffle strap, which is cool because people do love them. It is interesting though that then again, as usual, they sort of they beefed it up. Seiko, and they're making things beefier. This one, it's a very soft rubber versus the older original material. This is an original XGL 731 tire tread strap. It's the original strap for this watch model right there. And this is the original material, and this is, it's flexible, but it's thinner and it's a little harder and it doesn't grip. It has a little more slide on it. This is like that kind of rubber that just like feels like it's laminated to your wrist, but it is quite comfortable. Quite comfortable, and visually it looks nice. But the slider is metal. I don't know. Someday I think I need to sit down, you know, get Seiko over here and sit them down and have a talk with them. Maybe we can straighten all this stuff out. I'm joking, of course. I'm just some jerk. They're Seiko, but you know, I have my opinion, but they're the ones I'm talking about. If I wanted to put my money where my mouth was, I'd make my own watch. Okay, that's it. I will try to stitch these two videos together, and there we are. Thank you so much for watching.